A very good morning and welcome back to the course of Micro Engineering. So in our previous lectures we have gone through the variety of different microtubes. The microtubes were generally classified into two types, linear beam tubes and cross filled tubes. And towards the end of the module we saw a special type of a microtube whose operation is entirely different from the process what we call it as a velocity modulation, which is commonly found in all these earlier conventional and hybrid type of microtubes. So in this lecture or tutorial we are going to solve few numerical exercises based on the working principle of these different types of conventional tubes. So in this particular session we are going to solve the numerical example with which the various different parameters of these conventional tubes that we are going to evaluate by taking the different types of example. So let us begin with the examples on the microtubes. The first example is in front of you. So this example is based on the traveling wave tube amplifier. Okay, so let us solve one by one these examples, and here we are going to make use of formulae which we saw during the derivation of various kinds of a parameter to the related conventional microwave tubes. So some of the examples we are going to solve today over here. The first example is based on a traveling wave tube amplifier. First of all, I will read out the problem statement. This is a numerical problem based on traveling wave tube amplifier. So in the design statement, a traveling wave tube amplifier has following characteristics. The characteristics of the traveling wave tube amplifiers are given over here. Okay, so all these are the provided information, given information. So this given information I will read out. First thing that is given, the beam voltage, DC beam voltage, that is V0, that is given 3 kilovolts. Beam current magnitude is given, that is 10 milliamperes. Operation frequency of the traveling wave tube is given, that is 8.5 gigahertz. The circuit length, capital N, it is given as a 42. Characteristic impedance of the helix, Z0, is given 120 ohm. And it is asked us to determine what is the gain parameter, what is the phase constant, and what is the power gain of a traveling wave tube amplifier. So the given data is in front of us and we are asked to calculate these three parameters of the traveling wave tube amplifier. Okay, so we just recall the explanation of traveling wave tube amplifier and the gain characteristics. Okay, so we are going to make use of formulae for the same. So here I will begin the solution for this problem. Okay, so the solution over here, we begin with the given data. Okay, so the gain parameter, I will write here equation of gain parameter of TWT. So the equation for the gain parameter is given as a capital letter C. We denote the gain parameter of traveling wave tube amplifier as capital letter C, and the equation is the DC current multiplied by characteristic impedance Z0 divided by 4 times DC applied voltage V0 raised to 1/3. So in this particular equation we will put all the above quantities which are given. Now one by one we will place all these quantities values over here, right? So I0 is a 10 milliamperes. Everything we need to put in standard SI unit. 10 milliampere means 10 × 10⁻³ ampere. The Z0 characteristic impedance is 120 ohm divided by 4 times the DC voltage V0, that is 3 kilovolt. 3 kilo means 3 × 10³ volts, and all bracket raised to 1/3. Okay, and then we calculate the gain parameter. When you simplify this particular calculation, gain parameter is evaluated to a value, gain parameter is equal to C, is equal to the value we are going to get around 4.786 into 10 raised to minus 2. Okay, so this is a particular gain parameter. Okay, so here the phase constant is asked and the power gain of the traveling wave tube is asked. So the phase constant, how it is given? Again, the formula, phase constant it is beta e is equal to omega upon v0, where v0 is the velocity. Okay, so this v0 is written in terms of applied DC field. Okay, so omega is nothing but a 2 pi f, right, divided by v0. You just recall that DC v0, where v0 is DC electron velocity, and that is constant, and it depends upon applied DC voltage, and how it is given? 2 e v0 by m, right? So v0 is, capital V0 is DC potential. Now if you substitute the value of charge on electron and mass on electron, so the value of DC electron velocity v0 comes out to be approximately 0.593 into 10 raised to 6 times square root of applied DC voltage V0. So in the equation of phase constant, we will replace this value of DC electron velocity. Therefore, the phase constant beta E becomes 2 pi f divided by, we are going to substitute this equation, 0.593 into 10 raised to 6 multiplied by square root of V0. Now we will place all these values are available. So 2 pi, so the frequency of operation is given. Frequency of operation is 8.5 gigahertz, right? So I will write here 8.5 into 10 raised to 9 gigahertz divided by 0.593 into 10 raised to 6 into square root of applied DC voltage, and that is 3 kilovolt. So this can be written as 3 kilovolt means 3000 volts. So 3 into 10 raised to 3 volts. So if, when you simplify this particular, solve this equation and value of phase constant. So the phase constant is approximately, when you solve this calculation, you will get around 1.644 into 10 raised to 3 radians per meter. So approximately this value of phase constant you are going to get. So the gain parameter is already calculated over here. I request you people to calculate manually from your side and check the answer of calculation. Okay, so the next is output power gain of the traveling wave tube amplifier. So here I will write output power gain of traveling wave tube amplifier, UT. So how it is given, the output power gain? It is given as power gain AP in decibel. We know the equation. This equation is minus 9.54, if you recall, a standard equation to calculate the power gain of TWT, 47.3 multiplied by N multiplied by C, where N is a circuit length and C is the gain parameter. So here power gain is given by in dB. So when we substitute all these values over here, minus 9.54 plus 47.3 multiplied by N. Now N here is the circuit length. Circuit length is a dimensionless quantity, and the value given over here is 42 multiplied by C. C is the gain parameter. So 4.786 into 10 raised to minus 2. Okay, so if you substitute and if you evaluate the gain parameter of power gain, so approximately the value you are going to get around 85.54 dB. So if you notice, the power gain provided by this traveling wave tube amplifier is around 85.54 dB, and this is a very large power gain provided by traveling wave tube amplifier. So that's why traveling wave tube amplifiers are preferred to be utilized for micro amplification, and they also consist of a lightweight, so hence they are preferred over two cavity klystron amplifier, right? So we will move ahead for the next example. Okay, so what is the next example? So this next example is based on a reflect klystron. Okay, so here first of all I will read out the problem statement. A reflect klystron oscillator has the following parameters. The parameters are given: the DC accelerating voltage V0, or it is also denoted by VDC, it is given. So the value of this accelerating voltage is 1.5 kilovolt. Repeller voltage, the negative potential voltage is -100 volt. Resonant frequency of the cavity of the re-entrant cavity is 8 gigahertz. The spacing between cavity and repeller, it is normally called as a drip space, that is denoted by capital letter L, 2 centimeter given. And it is asked to calculate what is the DC electron velocity and what is the round trip DC time of the electron for this reflect klystron operation. Okay, so first of all we need to write the appropriate formula to calculate these quantities of the reflect klystron. So here in the solution we begin with all the above quantities are specified and their shortcut levels are also mentioned over here. So first of all we need to first find out the ratio of charge of an electron to its mass. Okay, so here let's say E is the charge on electron, because this quantity E by M is required during the calculation. We know that the charge on electron is around 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 coulombs. Okay, and small m denoting mass of an electron. Okay, so the approximate value of the mass of electron is 9.11 into 10 raised to minus 31 kilograms. Okay, so when you take the ratio of charge to mass, of an electron, so this ratio E by M, if we take the ratio E by M, we place these values: 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 coulomb divided by 9.11 into 10 raised to minus 31. So this comes out to be around 1.756 into 10 raised to 11. So this E by M ratio found out to be approximately this value, right? So the DC electron velocity, we already know the general formula how it is calculated, the DC electron velocity of the electron. So here DC electron velocity, so this is the velocity of the electron when the electrons are getting emitted by the cathode. So how it is denoted by V0, DC electron velocity, we know it is 2E V0 by M, where V0 is a capital V0, right? And this capital V0 value is given over here, that is a DC voltage 1.5 kilovolt. Okay, so we already know the ratio of E by M, so we can write the ratio E by M as 2 multiplied by 1.756 into 10 raised to 11. Okay, so what is the V0 value? It is 1.5 kilovolt, 1.5 into 10 raised to 3 volt, and all this is under a square root. Okay, so this velocity is then given by V0, DC electron velocity. So if you recall that the DC electron velocity is only dependent on what you are supplied with the DC voltage, that is dependent on V0, please remember. Rest of the things are going to be constant. So the DC electron velocity is only going to depend on what value of DC potential you are applying, right? So when you calculate the DC electron velocity, it will be around approximately 2.296 when you calculate solve this 10 raised to 7 meter per second. So this is the DC electron velocity value. Okay, so the next is, we are also asked to calculate what is the round trip DC time of the electron. So if you recall the equation to calculate round trip DC transit time of an electron in the reflect klystron operation, so what is the equation given is, so here round trip DC transit time of electrons, how it is given, so we know from that particular derivation it is denoted by T0 dash. Okay, and equation we saw, it is equal to 2m capital L V0 divided by E repeller voltage plus DC voltage. Okay, so here we need to place all these values. Okay, so m is a mass of electron and E is the charge on electron. We need to take the reciprocal of this quantity. So here DC transit time T0 dash is equal to 2 multiplied by m by E. I will take E by m reciprocal of, so it will give me 1 upon 1.756 into 10 raised to 11, because this ratio is indicating m by E ratio. Okay, so multiplied by L. What is L? L is the distance between cavity and repeller, and that is specified over here. It is a 2 centimeter. So 2 centimeter means 2 into 10 raised to minus 2 meters. Okay, into V0. V0 is how much? V0 is 1.5 kilovolt positive. 1.5 into 10 raised to 3 divided by, into bracket, repeller voltage, it is minus 100 volt, right, plus the DC potential voltage 1.5 into 10 raised to 3. Okay, so we need to solve this particular calculation and we will get the DC transit time of an electron approximately equal to, when we solve this calculation, 3.734 nanosecond. So approximately 3.7 nanosecond is the DC round trip transit time of the electron we are going to get. Okay, so this completes the particular example of reflect klystron. So we will move ahead for the next example, the third example. Okay, now the third example is based on two cavity klystron amplifier. So first of all, I will read out the problem statement. The problem statement is, a two cavity klystron amplifier has following parameters. The parameters are given as DC voltage for electron acceleration given, that is a DC voltage denoted by V0, 1 kilovolt. Beam resistance is given, that is 35 kilo ohm. Operation frequency 3.1 gigahertz. The gap spacing of the buncher and catcher cavity is very narrow and it is specified as a 1 mm, that is denoted by small letter d. The spacing between two cavities, actually this is a drift space and it is denoted by capital letter L. Beam loading shunt impedance, the loading effect is going to create certain value of a resistance and that is given 30 kilo ohm. Bunching factor is specified and the complex Bessel function at the bunching factor is specified, right, and this is a standard value of a Bessel function which appears at a bunching value of 1.841. And it is asked us to calculate what is the voltage gain provided by this two cavity klystron amplifier, right. So here to calculate the voltage gain, we need to calculate the intermediate parameters first. Okay, so first of all, we need to calculate what is the DC electron velocity. So step by step, we'll proceed for this example. So in solution, everything is specified in the problem statement. We directly start with the solution. DC electron velocity first we will find. So DC electron velocity first we will calculate. How it is calculated? V0. Again the same formula, 2e V0 by m square root. Okay. So when you substitute the standard values of charge to mass of electron, we are going to get this value is equal to 0.593 into 10 raised to 6, and only it going to depend upon the applied DC voltage. Now the applied DC voltage we know that is 1 kilovolt. Okay, so when we substitute over here, 0.593 into 10 raised to 6 into square root of 1000, right? So the DC electron velocity we are going to get approximately 18.75 into 10 raised to 6 meter per second. This is the DC electron velocity. That means when the electrons are released by cathode, the propagation speed of the electron, that is we call it as a DC electron velocity, it will be around 18.75 into 10 raised to 6 meter per second. Okay. Now next we will calculate DC transit angle. DC transit angle. So how the DC transit angle in two cavity klystron is calculated? The equation is theta g, if you recall. So this theta g is equal to omega d divided by v0, right? Omega d by v0. Omega is nothing but angular frequency, 2 pi f, and d is a spacing of cavity. Okay. Now all the things are known to us. We can substitute these values. The frequency of operation is 3.1 gigahertz, right? So here 3.1 gigahertz, 10 raised to 6. The spacing of cavity gap, that is small d, it is 1 millimeter, 10 raised to minus 3 meter, right? And divided by the DC electron velocity that we have got, 18.75. into 10 raised to 6 meter per second. So when we calculate, simplify this equation, the DC transit angle we will get around 1.038 radian. Okay, so we'll get this value of DC transit angle. Okay, so from this we can calculate the beam coupling coefficient now. Okay, so the beam coupling coefficient, we already know the particular parameter. The beam coupling coefficient will have maximum coupling of 100%, at which the coefficient becomes 1. So beam coupling coefficient indicate how much actually the coupling is taking place. So how it is given? Beam coupling coefficient beta is equal to, it is generally given by sine of theta g divided by 2, it is sine x by x function, if you recall, divided by theta g by 2, sine x divided by x. It is a sinc function type of a formula. Okay, so here we already know what is a theta g. Theta g, it is in radian, right? So here while calculating the beam coupling coefficient by this particular equation, make sure that you need to appropriately convert that in terms of degrees. Okay, so here we will put our calculator in radian mode for calculating the sine of argument. So here sine theta g is 1.038 by 2 divided by 1.038 by 2. Now here the instruction is put calculator in radian mode. Okay, during calculation. So the beam coupling coefficient approximate value we are going to get around 0.9556. Okay, so this is the value of beam coupling coefficient. It is always lesser than 1. Okay, so from here we will calculate the DC transit angle. Okay, so the DC transit angle, so theta is a DC transit angle. How it is calculated then? DC transit angle, the equation is omega t, right? Omega t0, the t0 can be replaced as L by V0. right, L by V0, and omega is nothing but 2 pi f L divided by V0, right? So here we can place this value 2 pi. Frequency of operation is specified, that is 3.1 gigahertz into L, that is a drift space. Drift space is given 4 centimeters, 4 into 10 is to minus 2 meters, divided by the DC electron velocity, that is we have already calculated in step number 1, 18.75 into 10 is to 6. Okay, so when you substitute all these things over here, we will get the DC transit angle around 41.5 radians. Please remember, we get the angle calculation in radians over here. Okay, and then voltage gain of two cavity klystron amplifier, here I will write voltage gain of two cavity klystron amplifier . So how it is given? It is given by a formula. Voltage gain AV is equal to, the formula is beam coupling coefficient square into theta 0 into shunt resistance multiplied by the Bessel function J1 of X at bunching factor, it is specified, okay, divided by DC resistance multiplied by X, where X is a bunching factor. So here one by one we will place the values. So beta square over here is 0.9556 whole square. Theta 0 is in radian, we need to place 41.5, that is in radians. The shunt resistance is given over here, specified, that is 30 kilo ohm. So put 30 kilo ohm, 30 into 10 raised to 3. The Bessel function J1 of X, that is specified over here, 0.582 standard function. Whole thing divided by R0. What is R0? R0 is a DC beam resistance, 35 kilo ohm. 35 into 10 raised to 3. Kilo ohm multiplied by the bunching factor X. Okay, so it is 1.841. Okay, and then when we solve this calculation, okay, so approximately the voltage gain we are going to get around 10.27. So the voltage gain factor for this two cavity klystron amplifier, approximately we are going to get around 10.27. Okay, and this will complete this particular third example. We'll move ahead for the next example, again it based on two cavity klystron amplifier. Okay, so we go to that particular example now, and we will try read out this particular problem statement. So this is the example of two cavity klystron amplifier, right? Right, that is the example number 17. Example number 4 over here, that is a two cavity klystron amplifier based on the same example number 4. Now here, first of all, I will read out the problem statement. A two cavity klystron amplifier is operated with beam voltage of 3 kilovolts. If the coupling coefficient is 0.9 and the magnitude of signal voltage at the input cavity gap is 100 volt, then find out the velocities of the electrons leaving this input gap. So first of all, step by step, we will write the given data. So we'll start with the solution, and in the solution what we do is, first we will write down the given data. So what is the given data? Beam voltage, first of all, DC beam voltage and it is denoted by letter V0. It is given as a 3 kilovolt, or it is written as a 3000 volts. Okay, so beam coupling coefficient is given, right? So the beam coupling coefficient is denoted by letter beta, okay, and the value is given 0.9. okay, so the magnitude of signal voltage in the input cavity gap is 100 volt. Okay, so the magnitude of signal voltage in the cavity gap, that is a micro signal, okay, microwave signal amplitude, which is introduced at the puncture cavity, micro signal amplitude. Okay, so this we denote with a letter capital V1. This is given as 100 volts. Okay, then it is asked to find out what is the velocities of the electrons which the electrons are going to acquire while leaving this particular gap. Okay, so if you recall the velocity modulation equation as the first derivation we saw in the case of two cavity klystron amplifier, we are going to make use of those equations of velocity modulation. Okay, so if we recall velocity modulation equations, are given by, so if you recall the derivation, we can easily write down the two different velocities. One is a velocity with which the accelerated electrons will propagate, and other is a velocity with which the electrons will propagate with slower velocity. So we have two separate equations for the velocity: velocity with increased value and velocity with decreased value. Okay, so that velocities we are calculating at time t1, during which the electrons are supposed to exit the gap. Okay, so this is given by V0 DC velocity into bracket, we know 1 plus beta I V1 upon 2V0, if you recall that velocity modulation equation, sine of omega T1, right, plus theta G by 2. This was that equation. Okay, so this is a particular equation of accelerated electrons, accelerated velocity of electron, accelerated velocity of electron. And similarly, the slowdown electron speed is given, which will exit the cavity at same time t1 V0 into bracket 1 plus beta I V1 upon 2V0, right, sine of omega T1, and here instead of plus theta G by 2 we need to write minus theta G by 2. Okay, and this is deaccelerated velocity of electron when the electrons are supposed to leave the cavity gap. Okay, now here the DC electron speed, where V0 over here is the DC electron velocity, so it is already, we know how it is calculated, 2E V0 by m square root of. Okay, so this can be simplified. So how this can be simplified? So how this is written? 0.593 into 10 raised to 6, this particular term. So 0.593 into 10 raised to 6, and it only depends upon the accelerating DC voltage V0. Okay, so when you substitute over here, 0.593 into 10 raised to 6 into V0 V0 is 3 kilovolt, that means square root of 3000 volts. Okay, so here approximately the DC electron velocity we are going to get around 32.48 × 10⁶ meter per second. When you calculate, you should get near about the same value. Okay, so how the beam coupling coefficient is given? So the beam coupling coefficient is calculated from the theta g part. Okay, so theta g, that is the transit angle. Okay, so that we want to calculate. Now the beta is given, beam coupling coefficient. So what we know, beam coupling coefficient, I write here beam coupling coefficient, that is given to us. So how it is equal? So beam coupling coefficient beta has the equation of sine x by x formula, sine theta g by 2 by theta g by 2, right? So what we know over here, this value we know is equal to 0.9. okay, so from which what we can get, we can get from here, we calculate what is the value of theta g. Okay, so theta g we will find it will be pi by 2 radian. Okay, but we know that theta g, how it is written, theta g is the angular gap frequency. Okay, so theta g is given by omega d by v0, right? Omega d by v0, right? And how the time t1 is given? Time t1 is given, time is equal to distance covered by a velocity. So the distance covered is nothing but the gap of the cavity. Okay, so from here, this particular equation, how the value of d is given? The value of d, so d we can write as theta g v0 divided by omega. So here what we can substitute this value of theta g into v0 by theta g v0 by v0 into omega. So what we get, the equation is equal to theta g divided by omega, right? So and the at first velocity t0 is a zero, right? So here then we can substitute these values over here. Okay, so velocity of accelerated electrons is given with above equation, then we substitute simply v of t1. So here how we can calculate the maximum velocity, this velocity we can call it as a maximum when we add the sine term. So v0 we have found out 32.48 × 10⁶ meter per second, into bracket we are using this particular equation over here, the first one, this equation, right? And here we substitute, so 1 plus 1 plus. Now beta I, what is the value of a beta I? So beta I we already know the beam coupling coefficient, that is 0.9, right, multiplied by v1. V1 is the magnitude of microwave signal, that is 100 volt, divided by 2 V0. Okay, so 2 capital V0, capital V0 is a DC voltage, that is 3000 volt, right? Substitute this value into sine of omega. Okay, so omega is nothing but 2 pi f. okay, so omega is nothing but a 2 pi f. So omega t1, okay, so here from this particular equation, okay, so here we have got t1 is equal to theta g omega, therefore omega t1 is equal to theta g. Okay, so what you can substitute over here, so omega t1, so omega multiplied by what is the value of T1? We have got T1 is equal to theta g by omega, right? Minus theta g by 2. Okay, so what is the value of theta g by 2? So theta g we have got pi by 2. So theta g by 2 is pi by 4. Bracket complete. Okay, so you substitute all these values over here. Theta g you substitute pi by 2 in radians, and when we calculate this particular maximum velocity, we will find that it will be approximately 32.96 into 10 raised to 6 meter per second. This is the maximum velocity with which the electrons are going to exit from the gap. Okay, so similarly, the minimum velocity of deaccelerated electrons at time t1, the minimum velocity is given by, simply you need to reverse the last part in the argument. Same equation, now we are going to make use of the second equation, this equation, right? So here we write, what is the value of V0, DC electron velocity, 32.48 into 10 raised to 6 multiplied by, into bracket, 1 plus beta I V1 micro signal amplitude by 2 V0, 2 into 3000 volts into sine of, okay, so actually this is a plus pi by 4. Okay, now here we are going to take minus omega t is theta g by 2 minus theta g is pi by 4, theta g by 2. Okay, so when you substitute all these values over here, what you get around 31.9 into 10 raised to 6 meter per second. So if you need to notice the accelerated velocity of electron, the accelerated velocity of electron is around 33 into 10 raised to 6 meter per second, while the deaccelerated velocity of electron is around 32 into 10 raised to 6 meter per second. So if you closely observe these particular values, we'll notice that these values are not going to differ much. So the accelerated velocity and deaccelerated will differ slightly when the electrons are going to leave the cavity gap, right? So these two equations are indicating that the velocity of electron is getting changed from its DC value. Okay, so the DC value of the electron velocity is calculated over here. So this is the unchanged velocity, constant velocity. This velocity is increased and it will be made accelerated speed of electron, 32.96, which is greater than 32.48. And similarly, the slowdown electron have the velocity 31.9. And here we can observe that this constant velocity is located between the maximum speed and minimum speeds, right? So these are the equations and the values of velocity modulated equations. Okay, so we go further for our next example, right? So the next example is based on a magnetron tube. Okay, so first of all, I will read out the statement carefully and then we will go for solving the solution for this. I will read out this particular sentence. A X-band conventional magnetron tube has the anode voltage V0 is given 50 kilovolt, and the current, DC current is given, that is I0, 50 ampere, and it is applied with an axial magnetic flux density which is specified as a B0 with 0.01 Weber per meter square, that is a magnetic field. Now recall that this magnetic field is oriented perpendicular to the electric field. Okay, the radii of cathode and anode are specified over here, where the cathode radius is 4 cm and the anode radius is 8 cm. Okay, so then calculate the cyclotron angular frequency, Hall cutoff voltage condition, and the same Hall cutoff voltage condition for the magnetic field. If you recall from the earlier discussion of the condition, finding condition of the cutoff voltage in order to generate the pi mode operation of the magnetron, we saw that particular condition is being called as a Hall cutoff condition. And this condition is either specified in terms of electric field by keeping magnetic field constant, or you can keep the magnetic field constant and vary the electric field. So Hall cutoff condition in order to achieve the pi mode operation of the magnetron can be specified either in terms of voltage, electric voltage or magnetic voltage, right? So here, first of all, we will write down the given things in the solution before beginning. So in the solution, the given data, we will write given data. So the given data is the DC electric voltage, which is supplied between the anode and cathode in the cavity gap, right? This voltage is very high voltage, 50 kilovolt, 50,000 volt. Please remember, DC electric current is also given. So DC electric current, it is given I0, right? It is a 50 ampere. It is also a very high current. It is applied with axial magnetic flux density. So the magnetic field density is given. Now please remember, this magnetic field is oriented perpendicular to this DC electric voltage, so that we get crossed fields. This is specified to be 0.01 Weber per meter square, that is given. Okay, so cathode radius is given. Cathode radius is specified as A, that is 4 centimeter. And spacing between cathode and splitted anode, actually it is not a radius of anode, but actually this distance is the spacing between cathode and splitted anode, which is specified over here as a B, which is equal to 8 centimeter. Okay, then it is asked to calculate what will be the cyclotron angular frequency of the electrons. Okay, what is the Hall cutoff voltage in terms of electric field, and similarly calculate the Hall cutoff voltage in terms of magnetic field, right? So this is given over here. So here one by one we calculate. So cyclotron angular frequency, frequency of an electron. So we already know what is the cyclotron angular frequency of electron. I will just summarize you. If this is a particular cathode, okay, so this is a cathode, and this cathode is surrounded by anode. Okay, so when the cathode will release an electron, the electron path will get bent and the electron tries to come back over the cathode in this way. Okay, so it will be redirected again. So the electron will continuously oscillate between the cavity gap, which is formed between cathode and anode. Okay, so continuously the electron will spin around this particular curved path. So the frequency with which the electron is continuously spinning in the gap of between cathode and anode with these curved path, we call this frequency as a cyclotron angular frequency. And how to calculate this? The calculation of cyclotron angular frequency is dependent on the applied magnetic field. So how it is given? The cyclotron angular frequency, it is given by omega c is equal to E by M into magnetic field B0. Okay, so here E by M, we need to place this particular ratio, 1.6 into 10 to the minus 19 coulomb, that is a charge on electron, divided by mass of electron. Approximately the value of the mass of electron we should take around 9 point, in the previous calculation somewhere we calculated the value 9.11 into 10 raised to minus 31, right? So we'll place that value, mass of electron 9.11 into 10 raised to minus 31, right, into the applied magnetic field, that is 0.01 Weber per meter square. Okay, so when we substitute all this, we will get the cyclotron angular frequency in radian per second, 1.758 approximately into 10 raised to 9 radian per second. So this is the angular frequency of an electron with which they will start spinning around the cathode and anode in between the provided space. Okay, so next is Hall cutoff voltage, how it is given. So Hall cutoff voltage is the condition at which this velocity modulation process will begin, right? And this condition can be separately given for the electric field and for magnetic field. So for electric field, it is given as electric field cutoff voltage VOC is equal to, if you recall from the derivation of magnetron Hall cutoff voltage condition, it is given by E divided by 8m, right, into B square, magnetic field square, small b square, that is a spacing gap, into bracket 1 minus a square upon b square whole raised to square. This is a particular condition. So this particular Hall cutoff voltage for electric field, now we can substitute these values. So the Hall cutoff condition for the electric field cutoff voltage, it can be given as 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 divided by 8m, 9.11 into 10 raised to minus 31, right, into b square. B square is 0.01 Weber per square, right? Now b, small b, is the spacing, that is 8 centimeter. So 8 into 10 raised to minus 2 whole square into bracket 1 minus, okay, so a is a 4 centimeter, okay, this is square, divided by 8 into 10 raised to 2 whole square, and this entire bracket square. So when we calculate by placing these values, cutoff voltage, Hall cutoff voltage for the electric field condition, we'll get around approximately 7.9 kilovolts. Okay, so this indicates that if we maintain the electric field voltage around 7.9 kilovolt, the process of velocity modulation is supposed to begin inside a magnetron. Okay, so similarly, the Hall cutoff voltage for the magnetic field can be calculated using equation. So here I will write, similarly, Hall cutoff voltage for magnetic field, so it is again given with the same equation, but in terms of magnetic field, how it is given? Magnetic field B0 cutoff condition, it is given by formula 8V0M divided by E raised to 1 by 2. Okay, so when you substitute all these values over here, it will be 8. Okay, so if you recall this particular magnetic condition VOC, so here we will find out this particular equation for magnetron. Okay, so this particular condition, cyclotron angular frequency, we calculated, right? So here EV0 by M, then BZ, okay, V0 M by E, okay, so raised to 1 by 2, raised to 1 by 2 divided by B into 1 minus A square by B square divided by, right, so here B, so we'll come back over here, So this equation is divided by, if you recall this, it was b square, right? So just I am confirming the equation. So it is b into bracket, yes, b into bracket. So b into bracket 1 minus a square by b square whole raised to, I think again it is square root, right? It is a, yes, only a square by b square. Okay, so we'll modify this equation. Then 8, what is a v0? V0 is 50 kilovolt. So here I will write 8 into 50 kilovolts means 50 into 10 raised to 3 volt. Mass of electron 9.11 into 10 raised to minus 31 divided by E, the charge 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 whole raised to 1 by 2, and this whole bracket divided by B. B is a 8 centimeter, 8 into 10 raised to minus 2 into bracket 1 minus A. A is a 4 centimeter, right? 4 into 10 raised to minus 2 whole square divided by 8 into 10 raised to minus 2 whole square. So if we evaluate this particular equation, the magnetic field cutoff voltage specified as a Hall cutoff condition, Hall cutoff voltage, say this will be approximately 0.025 Weber per meter square. Okay, so the Hall cutoff voltage condition for the magnetron can be either specified in terms of electric field voltage or this magnetic field voltage. Okay, and then finally we will solve one more example based on helix traveling wave tube amplifier. Okay, so I will read out this particular design example. A helix traveling wave tube is operated with a beam current of 500 milliamperes, a beam voltage of 5 kilovolt, and characteristic impedance of 35 ohm. Find the length of the helix in order to provide the output power gain of 60 dB at operating frequency 9 GHz. So first of all, in the solution, I will start writing the given information. So in the solution, first of all, I will write the given data. So the given data is, first of all, the beam current, DC beam current, obviously beam current is given. Beam current is denoted by I0. It is given as 500 milliamperes. Beam voltage is given. That is a DC beam voltage which we applied to the cathode, V0, 5 kilovolt, or you can write 5000 volts, right? Characteristic impedance of helix, characteristic impedance of helix, that is specified. Helix is a slow wave structure which is used in the construction of traveling wave tube. So this characteristic impedance we denote as Z0. It is given as a 35 ohms. Okay, and what is the output power gain that is specified? So output power gain, so how the output power gain is denoted by power gain AP in dB, it is specified as a 60, right? What else is given? The operation frequency, or frequency of operation for this traveling wave tube, F is equal to 9 gigahertz, that is specified. Okay, so what it is asked us to calculate, what is the length of this helical structure, that is our interest. Okay, so here length of helix, it is a dimensionless parameter. Length of helix, how it is given? this length of helix is denoted by L, okay, and it is given by the circuit parameter N multiplied by operating wavelength lambda E, okay, and power gain equation, it is denoted by AP is equal to minus of 9.5, right, plus 47.3 into N into C in terms of dB, okay, where the gain parameter, where the gain parameter, how the gain parameter is specified, gain parameter is equal to C, capital C, how it is given, I0 Z0 divided by 4 times V0 raised to 1 by 3. So how it is given then, so place the values, current is 500 milliampere, the impedance is 35 ohms divided by 4 times V0, that is 5000 volt, and whole raised to bracket 1 by 3, okay. So when we calculate this, the gain parameter, we will get around 0.0979, this value, okay. So here power gain is known to us, okay. So the power gain is AP, so we will substitute 60 is equal to power gain equation minus 9.5 plus 47.3 into N into the value of C, we have got 0.0979, and we will solve this particular equation from which we can calculate the circuit length N from this equation we can find out. So when we solve this particular equation, we will get approximately the value of circuit length to be 15, okay. So from here we know the value of circuit length. Now we need to find out the operating wavelength, that is lambda E. Okay, so the lambda E can be found out from the phase shift beta. Beta is equal to omega upon V0, where V0 is a DC electron velocity. Omega is nothing but 2 pi F, and the DC velocity is V0. Okay, so DC velocity V0, which can be substituted as 2 pi F divided by V0 is 2 E V0 by M. So this is the value, okay. So when we substitute this, 2 pi, operating frequency is 9 gigahertz, right. So 9 gigahertz can be written as 2 pi into 9 gigahertz, 9 into 10 raised to 9 hertz divided by square root of, okay, so this 2 into E, 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19 into V0, V0 is 5000, right, DC voltage divided by mass. Mass is around 9.11 into 10 raised to minus 31. So if you substitute and if you calculate this value of phase shift, this phase shift will be around 1.348 into 10 raised to 3 radian per meter. You will get this value of the phase shift. Once you know the phase shift, we can calculate the operating wavelength, okay. So how the wavelength is going to be calculated then? So wavelength lambda E is given by 2 pi by beta. So 2 pi divided by whatever value of beta we have got, 1.348 into 10 raised to 3 radian per meter. So this will give us the value of a wavelength around 4.659 millimeter approximately. So we know the operating wavelength, that is lambda E. We know what is the circuit length, that is capital N. Therefore, length of the helix can be calculated as, so here length of helix, that is actual length of slow wave structure. So here I will write into bracket slow wave structure length. So how it is given? L is equal to n multiplied by lambda e. So n we have got the value circuit length 15, lambda e wavelength we have calculated 4.659 millimeters. So the length of the helix approximately we will get 0.0698 meter, or approximately we can say 69.8 millimeter, that we can approximately take to around 70 millimeter. So approximately 70 millimeter will be the length of the slow wave structure. Okay, so this completes this particular example of calculating the length of helix traveling wave tube slow wave structure. Okay, we have gone through each and every variety of the numerical examples based on the different types of conventional tubes. We saw the example based on two cavity klystron amplifier, helix traveling wave tube amplifier, reflect klystron and magnetron. Okay, so I hope similar example will appear in the examination, and you need to remember and recall appropriate formulae in order to solve this particular example. Okay, so these examples are indicative of the same type, and such a kind of examples are expected in the form of a numerical calculation during our examination. So I hope we have gone through successfully solving some of the typical example which are based on microwave tubes, right? So here you can practice such a kind of example, you can refer to the different books, and you can solve the unsolved example and calculate the analysis parameter of these different types of microwave tubes. So I will stop here, and thank you very much.